Advent begins. When I was growing up in Hopkins, this was a meaningful time for me. In the darkness of the dead of winter, there were now candles. I used to light them and stare at one for hours. I was meditating without ever having heard what the word was. Christmas and presents were coming, but they were off in the distance. And yes, we were excited by that, but Advent was a deeper experience that registered somehow. Candles in the darkness of winter were conveying something to me. We had Advent candles at breakfast, a small ceremonial event every day in the pre-dawn darkness of the mornings. We read devotions year-round back then when we were younger, but candles evoked something in addition. They evoked the past. It was somehow ancient to be in candlelight. For my dad, there were memories that were not so beautiful. I did not know this until years later when my mom told me my dad hated the smell of candle smoke when we blew them out because it reminded him of being poor. But for me, this was the only time our cash-poor family spent money on candles. Decorations came out, which are rare in a Lutheran household. And the Norwegian psyche that was used to long winters of total darkness, so that the culture that flourished was about things that happened indoors in the dark, storytelling and music, which is what Advent is all about. Advent is a time when we tell stories that carry meaning. That is called narrative theology. What stories do we tell that help us build our God consciousness? What stories do we tell, and what meaning do we pull out of them? Do we tell unbelievable stories and expect everyone to keep a straight face? Or do we talk about amazing things that matter and leave aside unbelievable things that do not? This gives us a chance to review the name issue again. Jesus is a Greek name. A New Testament was written in Greek. Jesus was not Greek. His Hebrew name would have been Yeshua. If it were up to me, we would start calling him Yeshua right now. Yeshua is translated into English as Joshua. And Joshua, or Yeshua, means something like a savior of the people. So he was named Savior, in the same way that Isaac was named Laughter. So Jesus is our Messiah, our Savior, and we celebrate his coming. But why is he a Savior? What is he saving us from? Let's go back to Sarah and Abraham. In our stories from Genesis today, it stops a little short. There's some solid entertainment value in going a couple verses more. Let's go back and hear the end of the full pericope. A pericope is a section of the text that is of a piece. There's one story. The visiting angels, speaking for the Lord, have just told Abraham that a 90-year-old Sarah will have a son within a year. Sarah overhears this and chortles. That news would qualify for a snort, maybe even a spit take from anyone. Verse 12. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, "After I have grown old and my husband is old, shall I have that kind of pleasure?" The Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Shall I indeed bear a child now that I'm old? Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? At the set time, I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son.' But Sarah denied, saying, 'I did not laugh,' for she was afraid. The angel said, 'Oh, yes, you did laugh. Oh, yes, you did laugh.'" In fact, the laughter is embedded in our language, our historical theology, as the son that comes to Isaac, the son that comes is Isaac, and the name Isaac means laughter. Isaac is the father of Jacob, and Jacob's new name when he becomes dedicated to God is Israel. The impact of the Hebrew people in the world, which is immense, comes from a birth that is more than doubtful. It is ridiculous and therefore miraculous. And we laugh with skepticism, with doubt, and then with joy. But that is not unusual, because throughout the story of these people of God, there are stories of infertility and miraculous births. Sarah had Isaac. Isaac's wife Rebekah was barren, but God heard her prayer and gave her Jacob and Esau. Then came Joseph and Samson. Hannah had Samuel, which means heard by God. And now through Elizabeth in her old age, John the Baptist is born. And finally, Jesus, the miracle birth of another order, in line with the virgin birth stories of many different cultures of that time. These stories tell us how the Hebrews and their descendants thought about the power of God. The miracle births were markers that these men were set out to do something extraordinary. They were sent by God at a time when they were needed. And the only explaining they have at the time was, it's a miracle, and miracles come from God. So now we get to Advent. And I think we are all secure in the knowledge that we are celebrating the coming of Jesus. We celebrate on December 25th, the one we call Christ, the Anointed One, our Messiah, Jesus who will save us. And for the Jews, the term Messiah means he who will lead the people out of subjugation and will free them. They were freed from the Greeks by the Maccabee brothers. They were freed from the surrounding tribes by King David. They were freed from the Babylonians by Cyrus, who was not even Jewish. These guys were all military leaders, and they were all messiahs. Is Jesus a military leader? No. Is he freeing the United States from foreign domination? No. How then can Jesus be our Messiah? What is he freeing us from? Jesus is the one who reminds the Jewish people that God has done miracles for non-Jews. Jesus says the temple is to be a house of prayer for all nations. Jesus says that the wisdom of the Hebrews, the laws of the Jews, they are as good as anything out there. But it is not just about the head and what works rationally. It is also centered on the heart, that there is no rational concept that is more important than love. That the intellectual exercise of sorting out the world rationally and scientifically is important work, but not as important as going out and giving your personal love to the people that you encounter who need that love. And we all need that love. Chris Rock, the comedian, has two daughters. And he said, my most important task is to tell them every day that I love them. They need to hear that every day. We all do. And many people don't hear that at all. Jesus was born in a time of darkness and brought this light into the world and into his people. He was and is also a light to enlighten the Gentiles. That's us. Jesus teaches us how to be better Jews, how to be better people of the book. And that makes us better people than we would be without him. An existence centered on loving and being loved carries meaning in every breath we take. It does not rule out science or rationality. Those ways of thinking are, I believe, gifts from God as well. It was Albert Einstein who said, science without religion is lame. Religion without science is blind. So let us not let dogmas of the past drag us into an irrational present. Jesus brought us the light of learning in the Jewish tradition of storytelling, the collecting of wisdom, writing history and poetry and parables and songs, by putting love and love of family first and deepening our spirituality and then celebrating in community to be publicly grateful to God for the many gifts that we have received. Among them are the gifts of Mary, and here are two of them. First, she said, "I will do God's will to the best of my ability, even if I don't understand what that means." Mary says, "My soul magnifies the Lord." That is, my very being in perfect submission to the will of God becomes God intoxicated with the Holy Spirit, and I will live in a way that magnifies and amplifies God's love in the lives we lead. We can all try to be more like this Mary. Second, the Greek Orthodox have given her a beautiful title, Theotokos, which means God-bearer, the one who brings God in the form of Jesus into the world. She is the one we can emulate as each one of us becomes a Theotokos, one who bears God into the world. Each of us can bring God into our world, even if the pain of bringing God into our world is as great as childbirth. We have to be ready to give the gift of God's love to the world. We get that gift and we re-gift it to everyone else. We celebrate Jesus because he frees us from a loveless life. He frees us from a grasping and selfish loneliness. Jesus helps us to know we are loved and that the world calls us to spread that love to all those in suffering, in sadness, in want. God's love can liberate us from despair. Let us then begin the season of preparation, of waiting, of becoming open to the will of God. And let us gather in gratitude to mark this season of hope, which flickers like a candle in our own darkness. Let us pray. Dear God, Master of the universe, you created all of eternity out of nothing. You created a planet that we live on that has a million wonders, more than we can ever know. But you also love each of us, right down to the vibrating atoms that make solidity out of nothingness. Bless us with quiet, with the desire to be still, and to know that you are God. All this we ask in your name. Amen.